heard of her death in 1906, he requested some of a brain material which you receive. And what he did, he prepared out of a brain very thin slices and looked under the microscope. Now, what you have to know is, if you just look under the microscope on, you know, like brain tissue, you won't really see anything. It's sort of like a blur. So what you have to do, about scientists often, they use specific dyes to give the tissue some contrast, some color. And that's what he did. And strikingly, what he observed in her brain compared to healthy brains were these dense plaques all across her brain, which he termed amyloid plaques, and also these tangles, which he termed neurofibrillary tangles. Now, what we know nowadays is that these plaques in the brain in Alzheimer's disease patients are caused by proteins that are cleaved in the brain and sort of clumped together. And these protein clumps, I'm sure some of you heard maybe of amyloid beta or maybe tau in Alzheimer's disease. Really, what we know nowadays is that these protein clumps, they really progress also the more, you know, the disease progress, sort of really like the virus in the brain. Well, what are the causes of dementia? Well, if you would have been living in the 1800s, that may have been, you know, some of the causes they would have told you. I mean, wine abuse, I'm sure some of you will experience that sort of dementia tonight. I mean, some of them sound quite funny, I mean, menstrual disorders. But really, some of them also, you know, do make sense already, like back in the days. I mean, obviously, head injuries, you know, if you fall down, you injure your head, obviously, you can forget things. Progression of age. Age is still the major risk factor for Alzheimer's disease, not the major genetic. Also, syphilis can cause kind of dementia. And then there's some, you know, you may have to be in between a diet, I mean, unhappy love. I mean, I don't know, masturbation. but unhappy love, you know, maybe just the body stress, you know, that may cause at some point dementia. But really interesting, I think, is actually that menstrual disorders, because what we know nowadays, and that's actually a very solid fact, more women suffer from Alzheimer's disease or get Alzheimer's disease than men. It's approximately 60% of the patients are female, 40% male. Sorry, male, less, yeah, no less than well, nowadays, really, what we're saying, okay, it's a combination of things, obviously. So your lifestyle, you know, have you been active throughout your life, environmental factors, have you been exposed to certain toxins, etc. And obviously, there's also a big chunk of genetics behind dementia and Alzheimer's disease, that's the most common form of dementia. Now, this graph looks really complicated, but actually it's not. What you see here, I hope you can see it, are different genes, yeah? It's called, for instance, here, MET2C, etc. And actually mutations in these genes, and how often, how frequent they are in the general population, and how they are associated with the risk getting Alzheimer's disease. So you see here certain mutations that are fairly common. As I mentioned here, the MET2C gene, like approximately 50% of us here have that mutation. However, that is really not associated with an increased risk for Alzheimer's disease. Then there are certain mutations you can see here that are really rare, presenilL1 and presenilL2, as well as APP. They're super rare, but they're causative mutations, causative factors for Alzheimer's disease. So if you're born with that mutation, for instance, you will get Alzheimer's disease at a very young age, so starting from the age of 37. And what we know nowadays is really that these mutations are sort of involved in the protein clump formation in the brain. Another very interesting fact, I think, is that APP gene here is located on chromosome 21, and you know people who suffer from Down syndrome or have trisomy 21, they have an extra copy of that gene here. So at some point, like starting from the age of 50, 55, people with Down syndrome actually will develop Alzheimer's disease. But then there's one big gene you see here that is actually fairly common, I mean mutation, that is fairly common in the general population. Approximately 10% of the population has that mutation, and it is actually associated with an increased risk for Alzheimer's disease. And that's APOE4. The risk factor I'm doing research on. Well, what is APOE? APOE stands for apolipoprotein E. Really, the only thing I want you to know about it, what it does in your body, it transports fats and lipids as well as cholesterol all across your body, so from, you know, from your liver to other parts of your body. and it does the same also in the brain. Now we know in a general population there are three types, three mutations we know of, called APOE3, APOE2, and APOE4. And really you can sort of name them the good, the bad, and yeah, the normal. So most people have actually that APOE3 mutation. So that's why we actually say as scientists, okay, that's the normal gene, the most common gene. As I said, only 10% have APOE4, and only APOE4 is associated with increased risk for Alzheimer's disease, whereas APOE2, interestingly, seems to act protective. So people with APOE2, they have a lower risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. And this graph here, again, really shows you strikingly. So people who have APOE3, here, they may or may not develop Alzheimer's disease. Now, if you have APOE4, your risk is really increased up to 12-fold to get Alzheimer's disease. And again, it's striking when you see female with APOE4 at much higher risk. And also what is important is that people who have APOE4, the age of onset is decreased too. So they may develop Alzheimer's disease already at the age of 17. Now, what I want to emphasize here, I know nowadays it's really easy to get your genome sequenced and, you know, all that stuff. If you should do that and you should find out, oh my god, I have APOE4. It's a risk factor. It doesn't mean that you get Alzheimer's disease, yeah? I mean, not like the causative factors I mentioned before. It's like smoking cigarettes. You know, you smoke cigarettes, you may or may not get lung cancer. Well, what's wrong with APOE4? Why is it associated with an increased risk of Alzheimer's disease? There are many studies that have shown that APOE4 may increase the protein conformation of the brain. There are also other studies that have shown that APOE4 may disrupt the blood-brain barrier. So you know the brain is actually a very protected organ. Not many things can just go in. And studies have shown that APOE4 may disrupt that barrier. And there are also studies that have shown that APOE4 may be neurotoxic or cause inflammation within the brain. The thing is, with many other things in Alzheimer's research, we really don't know. It's sort of probably it's a combination of all these things that ultimately lead to this increased risk for Alzheimer's disease. Now, what am I doing research on? As I just presented in the previous slide, we know, okay, APOE4 is associated. There are many reasons. We don't know the exact reasons. However, why not finding, you know, a small drug that sort of turns APOE4 into APOE3 and therefore would abolish all its detrimental effects in Alzheimer's disease, all its detrimental effects. And that's what I've been doing. So I just started my third year, actually, of my PhD. So I've tested many different drugs that I got provided from the National Institutes of Health that are all drugs already in clinical use or that just entered clinical trials, you know, things like ibuprofen, etc. I tested them against APOE4, and right now I'm sort of in a stage of like confirming, do they actually turn APOE4 into APOE3, and therefore would decrease, you know, the risk for getting Alzheimer's disease. Well, yeah, that's already my talk. Thank you for listening. So that's the Sussex Drug Discovery Center. We are located